Okay. Well, thank you for all for being here and having me. I'm Christian Grothoff. I'm here to present Taler, which is at this point still a research project. So you can think of it in this sense as vaporware. It works in theory. We have the protocol and the crypto sorted out. But unless you really want to, you know, compile it yourself and use the command line, this isn't quite yet for you. But, you know, if we are able to find some qualified systems programmers and designers, and we are hiring, then maybe in a year you will be able to actually use this. So, with that said, hello? Okay. Well, what's the motivation? We've been talking about currencies a lot, so obviously we would like to have a currency. And my motivation is I'd like to have one that works nicely online, and I don't like it to work like that. Because right now, if you use any payment system online, mass surveillance kicks in very nicely. They know what you buy, where, when, how much, where you've been, and you'll become totally transparent. So that's something we want to avoid. Now, as you have heard many times today, one answer is Bitcoin. So for the Bitcoin fanatics, I have a couple of graphs here. Here's the first one. That's the value of Bitcoin since inception. The peak there is at about a bit above $1,000, and now it's back to about 400. Well, changes every day, obviously. So if you think of this as an investment or as an exchange vehicle, there's this little problem that for an investment, you might want to value some stability, some sustainability, as it was called before, and not, you know, extreme speculative value. And the same, of course, goes for merchants. If you want to change your price 5 times a day, you know, how many bitcoins do you have to charge today, and you have to check the stock market every 5 minutes, it may also not be the most convenient thing in the world. The second thing that was mentioned was that Bitcoin is, of course, a very efficient way of doing transfers. Both of these charts, by the way, are from blockchain.info, so it's not that I made those up. These are from the Bitcoin guys themselves. This is the cost per transaction. So how much does it cost to do a transaction in the system overall? So in other words, if you take a miner who gets some reward for mining a block, namely in terms of transaction fees and the new Bitcoins being created, and you divide this by the number of transactions in a Bitcoin, and then convert the Bitcoins into a dollar, you get this chart. The peak there is at almost $100. I checked today, it's a bit more down towards like $5. But if you want to do a credit card transaction these days and the store said, well, we'd surcharge you $5 for the transaction, right? Or if you were to pay in cash and they would say, well, we charge you $5 for the transaction, not so great. Now, this works fine if you're talking about international transactions where your bank charges you $25 today, right? Or if you're doing drug trades or weapons trades, you know, those things, then $5 can be okay. But I'm not quite sure that's okay for our mainstream currency that we want to build our economy on. Obviously, you know, efficiency and resilience, as we've heard, you know, there might be some trade-off, but this one is a bit extreme in my view. Now, the other thing is all Bitcoin transactions are public. As you know, there's this public blockchain which records all transactions forever. In other words, Bitcoin does not come with any privacy guarantees. Now, at a given transaction, I may not be able to tell who the two owning accounts are. But over time, maybe I can link transactions and figure something out about you. So you have no privacy guarantees. You might have some vague assumptions about privacy, but no guarantee. On the other hand, of course, the government will say, well, we can't guarantee anything about who does the transactions. So the governments will say, oh, all of these are evil terrorists, right? Well, you go and say, well, oh, if in the worst case, the government will know everything about me. And both are true at the same time. So that's already a problem. Now, in the future, what we have to expect are systems like Zerocoin and existing Bitcoin money laundering systems. Zerocoin is kind of the turbocharged cryptographic version thereof. And I know some people who are building actually it as a so-called zero cash implementation. And that will offer full anonymity. So you have no linkability anymore, which means you really have an anarchistic economy. Nobody can check who receives what money, who gets paid for what, and so on. Now, again, there might be some Bitcoin advocates who say, well, down with the state, down with the banks, we run our own. And some who say, well, maybe not the best thing ever to really make this totally trivial for the billionaires to shuffle their billions around. So I would ask the question, if we go down that route, is society really ready for an anarchistic economy, right? Where there is nobody in control, where there's no possibility of a state charging taxes, for example. Well, our answer was no. So the goal was to create cash, well, electronic cash, digital and socially responsible, by which we mean both privacy for the citizens as well as taxability for the state. We heard before some of the great examples for regional currencies come into play when the region allows you to pay taxes using those currencies, right? So the ability that the state can say this coin, this currency has value because you can pay your taxes in it, can play a very fundamental role, and we wanted to make that possible. So Thaler stands for taxable, anonymous, Libre, electronic reserves, and electronic, of course, you can translate as practical, and we would like to be resource friendly. So the other thing with Bitcoin, as you might remember, is the mining, which tends to consume electricity, which tends to produce carbon dioxide in some form or other, which might create other environmental disasters, especially if it's widely used. So here's the basic architecture of Thaler. So in Thaler, we have what we call a mint. And so a mint, you can really think of like the mint you have minting euros and euro bills today, or maybe a bit more like a bank. And the mint allows the customer to withdraw electronic coins. And the withdrawal process uses what is cryptographically called blind signatures. So this is a variant of a Chaumian currency for those familiar with those systems. So the customer somehow convinces the mint that he has, you know, paid in some money. So maybe the customer pays 50 euros via SEPA to the mint, and then the mint says, okay, now you can withdraw 50 euros worth in digital coins from me using blind signatures. And the key thing of blind signatures here is that the mint does not know the identity of the coins that are being generated. So the mint can later not link the transactions of the customer spending money to this withdrawal action. So the coins become anonymous at the withdrawal stage. That is critical. Then the customer can go and transfer the coins to a merchant. So he effectively signs with the coin, this merchant should be given these 5 euros or these 5 whatever units of currency. And the merchant can go back to the mint to deposit the coins and redeem their value, again, via whatever means are available. Now, in the meantime, of course, the mint had to hold the reserve currency. So the customer had, say, transferred 50 euros to the mint, and now the mint has to transfer some of that to the merchant. So the mint acts as a reserve here in whatever currency. And we have the concept of an auditor who can cryptographically check that the mint's operations are correct so that the mint operator can't just embezzle money and run away with it. So what are our basic requirements that we're satisfying in our design? Well, we have custom anonymity, which means it's not possible to trace the spending behavior of a customer. You should not be able to tell how I use my money. For me, that's very important. It creates all kinds of problems when the government can check on you everywhere you go. It creates problems with businesses that can do dynamic pricing and adjust their prices to what you do. Maybe not directly. Maybe they just sell the information to the insurance company who will adjust your prices. Either way, anonymity should be highly valued. Second thing is unlinkability. This is kind of also where our technical innovation lies. If you spend coins repeatedly at different merchants or at the same merchant, it should not be possible to link the transactions. So in Bitcoin, you kind of have this vague anonymity, but you don't have unlinkability. Over time, I can link your transactions and build a profile of you. So here we have unlinkability. So if I have multiple transactions that I've performed, possibly using the same, you know, money I withdrew from the mint, they can't be linked. Taxability. In our case, the merchant is fully transparent. So whoever receives money, you know, this could also be your income, the merchant is the receiver of money, he is not anonymous. He will be known to the government or to anybody who can check on the mint's transactions, is therefore auditable and taxable. Now, we don't say how high the tax should be or which action should be taxed or whatever. That's still up to the government. The point is, when you receive money, that is known. And therefore, I can tax you on income, I can tax you VAT, I can tax you sales tax, whatever, right? So that's important. Verifiability, again, the trust necessary between the participants is minimal. So in particular, the customer cannot cheat. He can't say, oh, I didn't spend this money, or somebody embezzled my money, or whatever. The customer withdraws money into his wallet. If his computer is hacked, well, just like when you lose your physical wallet, you may lose what's in your wallet, but that's it. And you cannot cheat. The customer can never cheat. The mint never has to go back to, oh, but this customer did something evil. He spent his money twice. No, it cannot happen. Right, that's a key difference to Chaum. And That, of course, makes the system more efficient if nobody can cheat. The same thing for the merchant. The merchant cannot say, oh, let's withdraw this money twice. The customer didn't pay me. None of these things are possible. And the mint, again, can be audited to make sure that it didn't embezzle any money and that it gave the money to exactly the entities that had proof that they should be paid. Okay, ease of deployment. Again, we can provide a gateway to an existing currency system. So with Bitcoin, you may have the problem, well, how do I get my first Bitcoin? You know, I have to go to a mining party where some miners hang out, right? Or go to some shady online site that may or may not be legal, right? Here, well, if there's a mint, which can operate, in my opinion, perfectly legally, you can transfer money to it using SEPA, using a credit card, using whatever existing payment system exists, and then they can give you electronic currency in return, kind of like an ATM. And of course, we are providing a free software reference implementation. So anybody who says, you know, we want to have a better designed wallet, a better designed integration with the merchant, we want to run our own mint, will be possible. We have low resource consumption, so there's no proof of work involved. Yes, we have public key cryptography, but not excessive. And so the CPU consumption will be way, way, way lower than Bitcoin. There's no global transaction chain to be maintained. Every mint has to keep track of some state, obviously, but it's bounded, and so therefore rather efficient. And we can support all kinds of different transactions. So we can support macro payments. So, you know, you pay 100 euros, pay 100,000 euros, doesn't matter if the mint has the capability to handle that. And we can also do micro donations. So we can have very, very small amounts and make those transactions for very small amounts very cheap. What are the assumptions for our system? Well, first of all, we assume for good custom anonymity that there exists an anonymous channel. In particular, when the customer interacts with the merchant, well, if he goes to it in person, the merchant may remember the face, right? If you use him over the internet, well, he may remember the IP address. So if you want really good anonymity, you have to have some kind of anonymous way to interact with the merchant, for example, using Tor. Now, assuming that works, yeah, some people will say, oop, but assuming Tor works, we're fine. Then we assume that some curve 255-19 elliptic curve cryptography works. Again, we have no proof that it doesn't. Chaum-style bind signatures should work, and hash functions should work in the sense of the usual definitions. Again, these are the mathematical assumptions we make. I don't believe they are problematic at this point for this system. So when you have a coin in Taler, it's pretty much identified by the public key. Only the owner knows the private key, so your ownership of a coin is you know the private key. And the public key is signed by the mint, so that in the signature of the mint determines how much it's worth. And so the mint can have different signatures for different coin denominations. As I said, it signs blind each byte anonymity. And when you then have such a signed coin, you can authorize operations, especially spending at a merchant, by signing using the private key of the coin. So again, the mint makes new coins for customer payments, and then pays the merchants when the coin comes back with a valid signature. It has to have a list of all of the partially spent coins, so it's online. Here, the mint has to be online for transactions to be performed. That's the one kind of big restrictions, that when you do a transaction, the mint has to be online to confirm to the merchant, yes, this coin hasn't been spent yet. But we believe in today's world that's a rather realistic assumption that you can have a business that is pretty much online available all the time. The mint earns money by collecting transaction fees, so kind of like a traditional bank, except of course that we expect that the system is way cheaper to run than existing systems, therefore the transaction fees could be rather low, and given that there is a free software reference implementation, there might be many mints and competition should work and hold the transaction fees low. And as I said, we don't have to trust the mint, and we can enforce that it's operating correctly. So what are the security properties we have? So when the customer is compromised, so you have your digital coins on your computer, what you will lose is the coins that you have on your computer. Now in Bitcoin, that kind of means you lose everything because you can only hold them on your computer. Here the assumption is you withdraw, like we withdraw cash from an ATM, some amount, 50 euros, 100 euros, whatever you trust. And then if your computer is hacked, well, that's the maximum you may lose. You won't lose the rest of your account because that's your traditional bank. So it's bounded financial loss. And for some of us, it might actually be worth more knowing that our computer has been hacked than that loss. So I think that's acceptable. If the customer is malicious, well, he can't do anything. That's the main thing. We don't need to know about the customer. We don't have to have agreements. The customer can do whatever he wants with his computer. He cannot cause any financial damage to anybody else. Now, if the merchant is compromised, again, I may convince the customer to pay the money to a different merchant by sending the customer different payment data. So, again, limited damage. If the merchant is malicious, well, the customer will have to sue the merchant to actually get the merchandise. That's the possibility. The merchant can simply not deliver the goods. Well, that's what we have today as well. If the mint is compromised, so the key is lost, for example, also the damage for the mint is limited. So the mint typically will sign only a certain limited amount of coin with a particular signing key. And so if that signing key is lost, the damage is limited to that amount. So even the mint, if it's really compromised and some hacker controls the mint, there is not unbounded financial damage. If there's packet loss in the network, or network doesn't work nicely, that's totally unproblematic. So there's no assumption about that the network works particularly well. If the mint goes offline, no transactions are possible for that duration. Afterwards, we can continue. Well, if the mint loses its memory, so the mint has to have storage, of course, for its transaction data, then, well, we have to have good backups. Otherwise, we can lose quite a bit. And if the mint is malicious, for example, it could take the reserves and run away, well, for that, we have to have an escrow account to make sure that the mint operator doesn't easily disappear with millions and and leaves the public to pay for it. And of course, we can audit the banks of the books of the bank of the mint to ensure that it has as much in the bank as it should have. Okay, state of the project, I said we have the cryptography worked out, we have the protocol specified, we have a prototype mint, we have a prototype wallet, we have a prototype merchant portal. Those are not yet public. We are launched the website today, like 4 hours ago, in German, French, and English. But it doesn't contain all the details, and we will add details as we can. As I said, I believe the protocol has to be an open standard so we can enable competition, so we can enable going away from monopolies. For existing currency systems, except Bitcoin, we often have these monopolies where there's a few companies controlling the standard enforcing rules. Here, it should be really something that is owned by society. We'll license the wallets under GPL or LGPL. There's still discussions. It was very surprising for me that Richard Stallman said that we should use the LGPL for the wallets when I went, what? You usually argue for GPL. The merchant integration will, of course, be with the merchant, but we will provide free reference implementations and, of course, also a free mint reference implementation. Here's a little comparison with cash, Bitcoin, Zerocoin, credit card, and Thaler. What for me is important is for the anonymity for the payee. He is not anonymous, right? We do not work when it's offline, but on all the other things we have, in some sense, I think of this as a feature. So we have the best of all worlds here in theory. Okay, so that was what I wanted to share. If you have any questions, please.
So I guess your website you send is, you launched a few hours ago, it's stellar.net.
Yes.
Okay, we'll tweet it immediately. Any question? Chris? Yeah.
So if I understand you, it sounds like you're trying to reach some kind of continuum of centralization and decentralization, that you're a little bit more decentralized than Ripple, for example, but more to the right of Bitcoin. Is that right? Am I describing that?
I'm not exactly sure where I would be in relation to Ripple, because they can also have many, many payment points. But it's certainly more centralized, I would say federated more than Bitcoin. And one of the reasons is if you want to have taxability, the state has to be able to say, well, these are the number of entities that are involved, these are the number of entities I have to audit. So our view is that the auditor might be, for example, the ECB or some other financial regulatory institute. And of course, every mint would register with them and say, look, we're doing these financial transactions. Here is the audit data you need to tax people. And if you're fully decentralized, then this is no longer possible. So we want to have many mints, right, so that there's competition. But it still has to be a finite number, both because, you know, the mints have to be trusted in the sense of they have to be audited. You also only get good anonymity if you have several customers for a mint. If you have only one customer per mint, you don't get anonymity properties. So what you might say mixing effect doesn't happen if you have too few institutions per customer. So that's why it's a bit more federated in this case.
So does the tax liability lie with the mint and not with the end user?
No, the tax liability is Mr. Merchant. So whoever receives the money, he is liable for the tax. The state also says how high the tax is. The system doesn't implement that. The system just makes sure that the state can check how much money you got and that there is a hash attached to it that says what you got the money for. So you can be asked to, you know, reveal parts of what the transaction was, not with whom, but you can say, well, I sold these, you know, billions of weapons to Saudi Arabia, and then they can say, oh, no export taxes for you.
So if you want to be a merchant, you do have to be public and transparent, is that right? We've got to know your legal identity?
As a merchant, yes, because, well, first of all, you would probably not want to do business as a customer with somebody who you don't know, and secondly, the mint has to transfer the money to that legal entity using more traditional means. So again, there is this notion that yes, the merchants are well known.
So
this is not for black markets.
Right. And so then it would follow that the tax burden that you charge the merchant would then presumably pass on that cost to the customer?
Yes, of course. That's okay. How we do it today. I'm not changing that part of how...
No, not at all. It wasn't a criticism. I'm just trying to follow the logic through. And then it follows through. I don't know exactly the figure, but it's something like 60% of the global economy falls under something called System D. And please do correct me if you know a better figure than that. And that is the shadow economy, the informal economy, the peer-to-peer economy. And that's where I see the axis going. That's where I see the trend heading. It's a much more... decentralized atomic level where I now own the means of my production and I'm able to
I'm not sure in the dark economy you own the means to your production. It just means that the state has no say and that you have weak states, failed states, bankrupt states because they could not effectively tax the economy, but of course they had to bear the burden for maintaining police, firefighters, healthcare, and so on. And so you have a dark economy, you head up as a weak state, and that's not quite something I would envision for my future.
But at the moment, our tax systems today, and it doesn't sound like it will be different on your system either, rely on self-reporting. They rely on people...
Yes. So far, they rely on self-reporting. And here, well, largely, right? I mean, it's a bit hard for me to hide my income from INRIA these days because it's kind of rather well recorded and rather easily accessible for the state, but much relies on self-reporting. And I want to be in a situation where you can't misreport your income when it comes to the TALA system, which means we can ensure that taxation follows at least the rules of taxation. Now, if we make the rules then appropriate, and you know, we can argue then politically what that means to have appropriate taxation rules, then at least we will not have tax evasion under those rules. And that's what I want to stop.
Thank you very much.
It seems that in your system there is nothing to prevent the state from inflating this currency. Why have you made this choice? Are you pro-inflation?
Oh, am I pro-inflation or counter-inflation? first of all, the system here is really just a payment system. The underlying currency can be euros, can be bitcoins, can be regional currencies, can be inflationary, can be deflationary. We don't say, we don't care. Right? So we don't make a statement on that. We just enable you to use some existing currency to do transactions efficiently with privacy for who pays and with no privacy for who receives money. How money is then created, right? How you first get money into the mint, into the system, that's outside of Thaler.
So you you have a
so we're neutral to that, technologically neutral to that.
Than let's say Bitcoin, for example. Hmm? You have more limited coins than some of the competition, or your scope is a bit different, let's put it this way.
What do you mean by limited coins? I mean, the coins are just representations of another existing currency.
Yes, right?
It's just a digital representation. Just like in some sense you can say the physical euros are representations of your digits in your bank account these days. And so we can build this with Bitcoin. You can set up a mint that exchanges Bitcoin for Thaler Bitcoin. You can set up a mint that exchanges SEPA transactions from euros for Thaler euros. Right? So it doesn't depend on any specific currency in that sense. And therefore, you know, I hope, again, we can foster economic competition between currencies because we make it easier to create a currency. If you create a regional currency today, one of your problems is you need to create a printing press that creates you some kind of secure physical tokens that can't be easily faked. Right? Now here, well, take the software, run. Right? How much easier is it going to be for the city of Rennes to set up their own currency if they don't have to worry about, well, how do I print this? I mean, printing the euro notes is a really complicated process. Right? So if you instead can do this digitally, you might have an easier time setting up alternative currencies. So we do not say Thaler is a currency. It's a payment system.
Okay, thank you.
Question? Any other question? Okay, so let's continue. Olivier.